choose which path to take.
Investing in the future, lost souls that never die.
Let's spread the gospel, live godly lives, by example lead the way.
Been easy for his family, all the things they've gone through. He's not a Bible character. He's Bible follower. The main character. And I pray, dear Lord, that you'll bless him to me. Thank you, thank you, thank you. For his friendship and his love for you, his church. As we have this time, I pray to you, praise Jesus.
Our text tonight, our text story, Uzziah, the king of the southern part of Judah, was
killed by Jacob because of his wickedness and his evil sins. And yes, all his brothers were also killed at the very same time, according to the plan of God, leaving just Isaiah's sons to carry forth the lineage of the king. That's all that were left, as the brothers were killed. But their grandmother had a different idea. This is one of the most heinous things you ever read in the Bible, when a grandmother steps in and orders the death of all of her grandsons. Now think about this. I don't, off the top of my head, I don't recall how many of them, but if there's one, it's too many. But a grandmother who should be loving on her grandsons, adoring them, admiring them, and exalting them, if you will, is instead killing them so that she could take over the kingdom. She had no place in the kingdom as far as leading, and she had no call in the lineage, but the only way she could do it was to remove her grandsons from the lineage of the kingdom. So this gives us a clear picture of the type of grandmother she really is. I mean, such a poor example. And yet, she had forgotten, in the midst of getting rid of these grandsons, she had forgotten the youngest one, Josiah. And he's just 1 year of age, and she had forgotten there was a one-year-old grandson. The type of grandmother can't even tell how many grandkids she has. But that's one of the most strangest things of all. I mean, especially the youngest one. You know, your grandmother's know anything, you know, the newest one. And that's why they put the bumper sticker on the back of the car and said, ask me about my grandkids. She didn't have that bumper sticker on her car, that's for sure. And you want to know about them. But I think about this, I'm just now becoming a grandpa. And I'm 62 years of age, my grandson, the only grandchild I have is three. And so I thought maybe if I kept adopting kids, I'd have more grandkids, that ain't working out. So I got to keep adopting kids so I can have grandkids one day. What's funny is because I've always looked older than what I am. And so many times people have attributed thoughts of my age as being much older than even your pastor is very old. So they thought that way. I was at my daughter's graduation just last month. Because she graduated from Golden State Baptist College. By the way, she graduated summa cum laude and won the Chancellor's Award. And just to let you know, she has her daddy's brain. So I'm out there at the graduation, and a pastor I know. I know him, he knows me, we know my name, we say hi by name. And he said to me, as I'm standing next to my daughter, who's 23 years of age, I'm standing next to her, and he says to me, he said, it is really great that you could come and be your granddaughter's, here's what it is. I'm 62 years of age, and you think my granddaughter is 23, and yet there are people that are 30 that have grandkids anyway. I just learned this, but it's hard to believe that a grandmother would give them her grandsons and kill them. It's very hard to understand. Josiah is the high priest, and he patiently protects Joash for 6 years in of all places, the house of God. Because he knows, the priest knows, Athaliah is not coming here. Grandma's not going to show up here. And then there's another reason this is a problem. I mean, proper grandma. What kind of grandma would then go to church? Well, he ever always sings about grandma's Bible, grandma's God, grandma's prayers, grandma's this. And if grandma not doing anything, she didn't even know where. She didn't even know she has a one-year-old grandson at that time, let alone that he's hidden in the house of God. And so for 6 years, they hide Joash inside the house of God. You just never know what you're going to find when you go to church. You might find one of your grandkids there. What I want you to see tonight is when high priest brings him out publicly to the people at age 7 to declare him as king over the southern kingdom of Judah. I want you to see in our text verse what he is given for that declaration. Verse 12. And he brought forth the king's son and put the crown upon him and gave him the testimony. And they made him king and anointed him, and they clapped their hands and said, God save the king. You see, the crown showed his position as the king. But what was this testimony about? Was that in reference to? Well, here's why it was important. The testimony
were the principles, the things of the lineage of the kings. These were the practices of good kings. These are who has came before you. What did he do? What he didn't do? How he followed God? How they didn't follow God? These were all given in this testimony. And why this was important is this. The crown showed the position of the king, but the testimony was the reason for the principles to keep the position pure. So he had the position of king by his lineage, but he was given the testimony to keep that position pure for the next generation. Every good king was so, not just because he had a crown passed to him, but also, and more so, because the testimony was passed on to him. And the reason he could be a good king was because he received the testimony of the previous king that was not altered in any way, shape, or form. Now, I'm done with the beginning of it. I added to this message earlier today, so I just want you to know, we're in for a long haul. Lock and load. Let's get through it, all right? The responsibility of good, godly people is to pass on their righteousness to the next generation. That's your response. That's my response. This isn't just preacher talk tonight. This isn't just for people that are in full-time Christian service or missionaries over the foreign field. This is for every born-again, blood-washed believer who knows God. You're supposed to pass your righteousness, your goodness, into the next generation. Even the world understands doing this in a worldly sense. They pass on their merits of earthly and recycling and save the whales. They've got that past the next generation, but what about the children of God? What we're supposed to be doing is making sure that those who follow behind us have the testimony that is correct. And I'm not just talking about any testimony. I'm talking about the same testimony that was passed on to you when you came into this world. We have been given in the beginning of our life, in our generation, that when the generation should be given to the next one, 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 2, and the things that thou hast heard among many witnesses, the same, I said the same, commit unto others, and shall teach others also. That's what we're doing. But we're not seeing it happen. It's not taking. Instead, what we do is say, well, how many did you have old buses? How many got in Sunday school? As though if they're people in church, and he said, we had 150 and a quarter. And I said, what do you mean a quarter? He said, I only got 10 and a quarter. I said, no, don't worry, you get away with that type of nonsense. This is it. I remember having big days as a pastor, and I was excited about it. And we had one day, on a big day, we had 1,509, and then I think we had 730 or so on buses. And so you see somebody say, hey, I heard you had 1,502. Yes, we had a great day, 156 saved that day. And they say, well, how many were kids? And so it doesn't matter because they're kids. And that's why we're in the mess we're in right now. And that's why the devil's getting away with it. Because he knows he's got the kids by the tail. And we're just letting them go because they're just kids. That's all they are. Tell you that one of the weaknesses of my current generation is that we have failed to pass this testimony on to the next generation. We're letting it die right here. We're letting it change. We're letting it get watered down and weak. And we're not doing what it's supposed to be done. So therefore, they're not going to live what we have learned and live because they won't even know it. They've got to know it. I'm telling you tonight that my generation's failing and falling and laying away the testimony. To the point where when my generation advocates the leadership of the churches in America and the world, the testimony of the next generation will be nothing but weak and wishy-washy and watered down to what our forefathers gave to us. I wonder about our forefathers like Jack Hyde, and our forefathers like Curtis Hudson, and our forefathers like Lee Robertson, and our forefathers like Tom Malone. We got it from them, and we got it straight from them, and their generation kept it straight. But we're not keeping it straight. And so now, the young people today face this onslaught of satanic oppression and temptation like no other generation has ever faced before. And they need help. They need a pure and a potent and a powerful testimony to help lead them through this water of decision and need in their life. And if it doesn't come from us, brother, they're going to get it from the devil. That's where it's going to come from. I say to you tonight, we need to give the testimony to the Lord to the next generation. For example, we need to give the next generation the testimony of the will of God. When I'm talking about the first and foremost of the will of God, it starts with why we are even on this planet. You realize Luke chapter 19 and verse 10, the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. So what do I know about that? I'm all for the fact he healed the sick. I'm all for he touched the eyes of the blind. I'm all for he raised the dead. But he came to seek and save that which was lost. That's why he came. And if we are not a part of why he came, then you've got to wonder, what are we doing? Say, well, I'm here just to praise the Lord. You can praise him better than heaven. I'm here just to worship the Lord. I can do better than heaven than I do down here. I would have to deal with sin and shame up there. Well, what can I do here that I can't do there? Just be trying to get somebody to cry out. That's what I can do. My generation has been given the mandate of the courts of sowing, and we need to leave it to the next one. Or you're going to stop in the succession of the Great Commission. And people are not going to hear the gospel. They're not going to know how to be saved. And so they're not confronting people one-on-one with their eternity. Their eternity, knowing they're going to heaven or hell. How many churches today have stopped sowing? You know, they were so glad for the COVID-19 to show up to now. Do that no more. People are going to hell in a handbasket. The church is nowhere in force. I gave my life to the Lord 43 years ago. It was the most natural thing in the world to be taught and to practice the sowing. 43 years. That was when I was taught this. I'll never forget the first time, preacher, when I went sowing. And I've been saved for a while, but I gave my life to the Lord for just a short time. And so I thought, I'm going to give him the sowing thing. And we're doing this all about it. And so I showed up to the Thursday night. I said, I'm so waiting for him, man. And the third time I went, for the first couple of times, I got to go to the assistant pastor. And I was doing this again, so what? He knew how to talk. I said, well, about the third time out, he decided to take somebody else and kind of give them an understanding of so what they had never done it before. And he said to me, I'm preparing with one of our deacons. I said, that's okay. They know how to do it. I've never done it before. I grew up Presbyterian. I grew up in a church where the pastor wore his wife's robe, had his underwear around his neck, and was icier than an icicle. So I don't know it. I said, but I know it'll be done because somebody needs to hear about it. So I'm willing to learn. And so he said, you're going to go with David in the church. Okay, well, he knows how to do it. So we're going to the first stop. We got a little bus together, and all of us got off the neighborhood, and we're going to the first stop together. And the deacon says to me on the way to the first house, he says, I'll let you take this first one. I said, I've never talked before. I don't know what to say. I didn't even know the Romans Road. I don't know what to say. And he said, I don't know how either. You're a deacon. He did not know how to win a soul to Christ. If two guys, neither one of them ever won a soul to Christ, I said, well, you're the deacon. You need God no matter what. He got up that car, and he was stammering and stuttering, and I mean, it was a mess. And that guy got mad behind the door because he couldn't even get his words out. He got mad, he cussed us out, he opened the door, and then his dog chased us out of the driveway and down the property. That's my introduction to Zoe. It's amazing that I'm still doing it 43 years later. I'm doing it not because dogs chase me and people cuss me. Have you ever seen what they did in the Bible, the people that tried to witness to them? Nothing with it in the Bible. I don't have to be a great soul winner, but I do have to try. And that's the thing. You don't have to be the number one soul winner in the church, but you've got to try. It takes everybody to get involved in getting the gospel out in this area. Everybody. It'd be great if we had only 30% of the people in this church doing it, but 30% of the people in the church next door and 30% of the people jumping down the church. Yeah, that's not true. You got zero there, zero there, zero there, zero there. It never be, can't be zero here, too. We need to get to 100%. Everybody involved. My wife and I just came back a couple of months ago now, from Ukraine. I've never been over in Ukraine. I said, I said, I don't care if we go back again. It's a very populous country, but we need the gospel. Then I can't speak the language. That's the biggest thing. I don't support any missionary over there that is. So we were over there, and we were adopting two little girls, 7 and 8 years of age, two different orphanages, and from the country. So we were there for a week, and this time I've been there four times. So we were there for a week this time. And we have a guy who who can speak English, whose name is Vitaly. Vitaly is a fine young man, a single guy, and he treated me like I was somebody. You know, he carried my bags for me, he had the door for me, he did this for me, and I mean, I felt like I was the most royalty to this guy. And he loved the blessing. And he knew everything about his country. I mean, he knew history, and he drive down here and say, now, this building was built this hour, this day, this place, these people. He knew the difference in where the Russians were involved in Ukraine, and Ukraine. Ukrainians don't like Russians, and you know, there's lots of reasons. We'll get into that another day. But we don't care for that. And so this is a Russian building. How do you know it's a plain building? This Ukrainian building, how do you know it's very ornate? And they're very loyal Ukrainian people. And he didn't tell me, build it, building a church, it's a church. And for about a week, the time we were always taking somewhere, sightseeing, showing something. Treat us like royalty. I told my wife, I said, I'm going to win this guy for the Lord. It just says God's going to save him, and I'm going to witness to him, and I think he's going to get saved. And so I waited always at the last day. Now, this is the very first time that I went there. And so they could wait the last day. I said, man, my dad, I said, I am amazed at what you know about your country. Hey, you put America to shame. We don't know U.S. history. We don't know the history of our town, our city. We don't know the history of your church. So I said, you put it to shame, many Americans. We don't know our history, you know yours. I said, but the thing is, you're telling about all these churches and when they were built and how many hundreds and hundreds of years old they are and all these things. I said, but the thing that you never told me yet is whether you're going to heaven or not. You know, for sure when you die, you're going to heaven. He said, I don't know that. I said, well, let's take some time to find out. And they sat in the little apartment there, and we got the kid. It was so easy, because he understood English, he could read. I said, let me sit in here for the book of Romans. And Romans 3:10, and Romans 3:23, and Romans 6:21, and going. And it was as easy as pie to be able to lead someone to Christ, even though he was smart and from another language, another country. Why? Because the gospel is needed across the world. I'm saying we can't just sit and say we're saved. We've got to get out there and get the testimony of the gospel out there. We are now graduating preachers from Bible colleges who do not and have not led us over Christ. They don't know how to do it. You say, oh, you're just saying that. That just sounds good to preach you. I'm telling you the truth. I witnessed that firsthand. I was preaching at church. I was preaching many times before. They got me a pastor. I didn't know the pastor, but he invited me to preach. So, about a week before I was going to preach at this church, where the deacon of the church called me up, he said, Brother Smith, he said, I want to ask you something. I'm not being critical. He said, I'm going to ask you something to help us with. I said, what are you talking about? He said, our pastor goes out with me so well, but he doesn't talk. He's never talked. He's been a pastor for here 6 months. He said, he's going out with me every week and so on. But he's never talked one time. I do all the talking. He said, I get the feeling he doesn't even know how to do this. He said, I'm really concerned about this. Can you talk to him? Can I talk to him? That's not my church. He's not my pastor. He said, please, he said, I'm going to be the leader. I'm going to do this. I think, why don't you vote him in there? So I thought, what in the world am I going to do for this one? The very first night I got there, the preacher greets me. He said, let's go out to eat. We went out to eat in the Olive Garden. And so we sit there. And I mean, we were 5 minutes after order. And he says, Roseman, I've got a problem. I've got a bad problem. He said, I said, what's your problem? He said, I grew up in a church that had soul winning, but I never went. He said, I went to a Bible college that had soul winning, but never required it. He said, now I'm taking a church as a pastor that loves soul winning, and I don't know how to do it. I tell you, we're in a time of precarious and perilous times. This is the issue tonight, and somebody needs to decide we're going to give the next generation the testimony of the will of God. It is the will of God that we get the gospel out into this area of our community. Not only should we get the testimony of the will of God, but we've got to get the next generation the testimony of the work of God. My generation was given the testimony of serving God. Psalm 100, verse 2, serve the Lord with gladness. Not grudgingly, not being forced to, not pushing your arm behind you. serve the Lord with gladness. You can serve God. You get to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the one who saved you. You get to live for Him and serve Him. Don't tell me that's a hard thing. That's a glorious thing to do. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse number 10 says, we are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Unto good works which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. We have prayed for, we have longed, and we've even sung songs longing for God to use us, to be used of God, to sing, to teach, to pray. This is what we want to do. The next generation followed us. They know nothing new to serve God. Nothing new. Because the churches are sitting in, going on the service back away from them. We just want you to come and enjoy church. I don't want you to join tonight. I want you to get stirred up. When I was a layman, my preacher get busy on something about reaching America, and I get to stir up and think, why does this have to be Sunday night? I want to get out and do something at the church. I want to tear something up, build something up, propose something. I want to do something. That's what I want you to do. I want you to get so motivated that we're going to do something. Amen. You know this new thing called recovery fundamentals? Recovery alcoholic. You know what they're whining about? We've been used. The preachers used us in church. I testify as a pastor of 30 years, I used a lot of people. I did. I used people to get on buses and bring kids from broken homes in inner cities who weren't loved and who were in many times were abused. And nobody cared. I used them to get them in church so they might be saved. Yeah, I used them. I used people to teach in Sunday school, teach about Jesus and the one who loves them and cares for them because the public schools weren't going to do it and mom and dad weren't going to do it. I used them to be able to teach them. I used them. I used them in junior church. I used them in teen church. I used people to sing in choirs. I used people to work in special management. Oh, I used people! I don't know a preacher's worth his weight in to blow up with power unless he says, I want to go to use me. I don't want to go to church and just preach. I want something to happen when I preach. I want God to use me. I've got news for you tonight. This life that we're living right here is about somebody else than you. When it got to be about you, it got to be a wreck. But when it got on somebody else, it got to be making sense. Philippians 2:4 says, look not every man on his own things, but look every man on the things of others. Lord, help me live day by day in such a self-forgetful way that even when I kneel to pray, my prayer shall be for others. Others, Lord, yes, others, let this my motto be. Help me to live for others that I may live like them. What is he was equal with God, but took upon himself the form of a servant, but you don't want to serve? You don't want to be used. What's the next generation going to be doing? I love the story. Salvation Army wasn't originally a clothing store. Originally was what it said to be about salvation. We moved out of the Salvation Army. He being an army-minded person, set it up like a military setting. He being the general thing. And every year they would have a main conference where they would try and motivate the delegates of the Salvation Army for the next year. And he would always be the keynote speaker at the end of the conference. And but his age was getting up there, and his body was getting weak, his abilities less. And they wondered one year, would General Booth be able to join us at the national conference? And they would encourage us for this next year. Nothing was said until the very last meeting where he would normally stand and speak. As he was to be able to stand and speak, the moderator stood and stand and came before the people and said, General Booth is not going to be able to speak this year. But he has sent a telegram. Admitting his bad health, he sent a telegram for us. I'm not opening it. I'm going to open it up and read it to you right here. The moderator opened it up and sent to the delegates of the Salvation Army. Others, starting with William Booth. I I tell you tonight, if you do not get this to the next generation filled with the selfies and the selfishness, it's going to be more selfish than you can imagine your mind. We've got to get this. It's all about others. And we've got to get to the next generation, the testimony of the work of God. Thirdly, we need to give the next generation testimony of the Word of God. The Word of God, which is in question now and never has been in the previous generation. Do you know that with the previous generation of our forefathers were so solid on the Word of God, they didn't talk about King James Bible because nobody thought about anything but that. They didn't even say, we're King James only. Nobody wants anything but King James only. Why in the world you got to say it? Because now you got 75 different versions, 100 different versions, whatever it is, today. It's crazy. You've got a Bible, Psalm 119 and verse 89 says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. So tell me why, pray tell, why it's not settled on the earth. When it is settled in heaven. Our forefathers delivered the word of God with an exclamation. Thus saith the Lord. But now it's then that God said. So the next generation is God in it. It's hard for me to even talk about how bad my generation is treating this testimony. Oh, it's originally inspired, my generation said, but we're not sure. It's just more than a translation today. You put a question mark where God has no, or where man has no place to put a question. And we wonder where revival went to. I was preaching a funeral one time, but it was one of those joint things where the part of the family went to a different independent Baptist church. And actually, the person who died was my member, but the people who controlled the funeral were somebody else. And so they controlled it, and they said, our pastor will help you, and we'll let him lead it. All right, well, I'm not, leave my toys and play by myself, I'll do it. And so this other pastor got with me, another independent Baptist pastor, he sat with me, and said, listen, I'll talk with the family. Here's what did work out. You'll do this, I'll do this, you'll do this, I'll do this, you'll do this, I'll do this. And he said, just one last thing I need to tell you. He said, no, the family has asked that we use only King James. He said, listen, he said, I know that's what's filling and we're stupid. He said, I need to stop following through with that. I hope it doesn't bother you if we would only use King James. That's not bothering me. I said, that's all I use. He said, you do? He said, oh, you're one of those kind. Yeah. See, when I gave my life to the Lord back in 1978, nobody even questioned this. It was the Bible. We never questioned this thing. And then the people of my generation started waffling on it and questioning God's word. Now there's question marks all over it. When should be exclamation point. I'm telling you, that next generation is coming behind us needs to know this is the word of God. Quit putting question marks where God put exclamation points. Not only do we need to get the testimony of the will of God, the work of God, the word of God, but we need the next generation to have the testimony of the wonder of God. One is so wonderful, many things, but one is He never changes. Malachi 3:6, I am the Lord, I change not. Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, the same. You notice that in Acts chapter 1 and verse 11, when Jesus ascended into heaven, the angel said, this same Jesus is coming back. I think He's even coming on the same cloud He left on. That's how same it's going to be. He's going to look the same. He'll have the piercings in His hand and the place in His side. I mean, it's going to be the same Jesus. Now that doesn't get any better. The same Jesus. I mentioned this morning, but my favorite hymn is Greatest Thy Faithfulness, because it means more to know He's not changing than anything else. Everywhere I go, I see change. Everywhere I go, I see change. Preaching's been changed to dramas. Music's been changed to appeal to the flesh. Separation's been changed into a preference. Song leaders have been changed into worship leaders. Preachers now are common laymen. Common people, the members of the church, are calling them by their first name. I don't call your pastor by his first name. You bet you're going to have enough slack. He's not back to you. He's up to his wife. But that's it. And then, by the way, if she gets outside with him, she won't be up with him either. Yes. And point of I used to be in churches in Maryland. Because the Independent Baptist preachers are sitting in the polo shirts and skinny jeans on a bar stool with a good team, and they're talking to people. No, they're supposed to be preaching in the church, right? Preaching. With the man of God, with the Spirit of God, and the Word of God together, do the business of God. That's what we got with the large Independent Baptist church out west. Dark in the auditorium. Got your blue lights up here. Six people up here saying you take the guy out of there leading songs, and you're one step away from the rock pit. Give it another couple of years, let's see it. Say, oh, it ain't gonna be like that. Yeah, it will be. Because nobody wants to keep the testimony out. This is not the testimony that was given to us. There's nothing wrong with the hymn. It don't need to be readjusted. We don't need two little ditties that we can sing so we can whistle them all day long because they're so funny and so cute. Wowie Zowie, the cat's got soul, he's the rock that doesn't roll. Let's sing that one over and over again. I'd rather have holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty. I'd rather have to God be the glory, great things. I'd rather have amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Don't you change from what you've been taught from the previous generation. Keep it the same. Because you can't pass it along if it don't stay the same. He gets the crown, but he gets the testimony too. It's the same. I think one last one that we're going to the altar. We need tonight to get the next generation the testimony of the worth of God. The worth of God. Do you know that the value of man in the sight of God really is immeasurable? How do I know? For God so loved the world. He didn't say so loved the perfect, so loved the rich, so loved the white, so loved every perfect person. He said so loved the world in whatever condition, so loved the world that he gave. You can't measure that. Yet my generation has changed this testimony. I'm not talking about abortion only. I'm talking about love for the brethren. Right or wrong, the same. Love for the children of God. My generation is the only generation to walk over the wounded bodies of their comrades in the midst of the battle. They didn't teach you that in the military. How is it that a secular military has more spiritual sense than most churches have? I mean, somebody messes up in the church and we cast them out and throw their name out and forget them forever. And if they ever wanted to get back and get away with God, they'll not get there. Because we've already posted on Facebook everything about it. We've got details, pictures, and all of it is just made up, but we've got it anyway. So we're going to try that guy in blood. God believes that people ought to be restored. What do you believe? Most people think they don't be destroyed if they sin. Yet we got this pesky verse in Galatians chapter 6 and verse 1. If someone is overtaken in a fall, you which are spiritual are to restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. How am I supposed to restore people that have fallen? Not walk over them and wipe my hands away from them and pick them as they're down. You know, we don't go like this to the brother now. We go like this. We make sure we get social media going against us so they'll never rise again. No place of repentance. No place. It's sad. It's shameful. When I was pastoring, man came to me and said he was leaving my head. That's hard to believe this. As fun-loving as I am, as good-looking as I am, as easy preaching as I am, it's hard to believe anybody ever come to me and say, I'm in my church. If you're talking about visitors, that's not the thing. The visitor will tell you. Came to our church, and there's a friend of one of our members, and I said, how did she like the church? Well, she won't be back. And I said, why is that? She said, you're just too. She said, I'm just kidding. So go on vacation, relax, come to church, get something done. So this guy, I had a meeting with the pastor, and my family's leaving. There's a problem. I don't mind who's in the choir in this church. So what do you mean? Who's in the choir? You've got a single mom in the choir. Well, 2 years ago, she gave birth to a child out of wedlock. She's repented of that. She's proven herself. She's lived right. She shouldn't be up there. Really? Now, people in the church with him. I said, let me think about this for a minute. I said, I'll tell you worse things than that. I know there's people that have been in jail in that choir. He said, there is. I said, yes. There are people that were in jail that were in that choir. I said, there's at least half a dozen, six or seven of the divorced people. And I'll give you one even worse than that. There's a former stripper in that choir. Yeah, you better hightail out of the church. You got an idea that this is something you see with all the relics showing themselves. No wonder we're not getting anywhere. Hey, if that next generation thinks that's what this is all about, forget about helping anybody. Forget about helping. I'll never forget. We had a lady in our church. She grew up in our Christian school. Got away from God. And she got a teenager. And they got married. Married the wrong guy. And started having kids. And then one day, she got convicted because she was not in church because she now had kids. And one morning, she got up on Sunday morning and here comes one of our church buses right down the street right in front of her house. She took her kids and went to church. She said to me, I need to come back. I'm sorry I did this against God and against you, but I'm coming back. And she came to the altar and got her kids back in church. But she couldn't get her husband in church. He wouldn't get saved. So she just said, I don't know what to do, preacher. And I said, you just keep coming. Friend that meal. Keep private talk. You just keep coming. And then you at least have your kids. And who knows how God can use that in your husband's situation. So he wouldn't listen to nobody. I wanted to talk to him. He wouldn't listen to the scriptures. She talked to him. Others talked to him. We were praying. I didn't go on the Wednesday night prayer list. And for probably about 8 months, this went on. And finally, one of my deacons went out there on Thursday night to pray to Christ. So here he comes Sunday morning, down the aisle, declaring his testimony, being out saying, God, and I'll get baptized, and he is out of the gate. And he's in there. And he's in every service. And then soon he's jumping on the soul winning bus. And then pretty soon after that, he's growing in the Lord, and he wants to be working on the bus route himself. And then pretty soon he's working this way. He's growing and growing and growing and growing. He grew so many times, so many different levels, and for so long that God called him to preach. We went to pastor school one year. With us at a group of men with the pastor school. We stayed at a hotel where every one of us had to check in separately, and so it's normal check in, and so your driver's license and so forth. And he still had his driver's license on his PC games, where your hair doesn't look back. And here he's just cleaned it. Look, I'm preaching. He's a preacher today. He looked like a preacher today. And so we did a show at a place that we were all together. I said, this is going to be funny. How are you going to prove this is you? Because it don't look nothing like you. So it's his turn to go up the window, and the guy takes his, needs a proof of ID, and he gives it to him. It's the wrong hair picture of him, and he's got this clean cut look. And so he looks at the driver's license, looks at him, looks at the driver's license, looks at him, looks at the driver's license. He said, what happened to you? I said, he got saved. That's what happened to me. Hey, when you get saved, what you say? All things pass away, all things are become new. It's the wonder of God. There's a change. We want to diminish that change. We don't want to help people that won't receive it, that won't turn from their way. We want them to step out, wash our hands of it, and show how great we are. We don't fall. No, you didn't fall today, but you may. And when that has happened, you don't long for somebody to come beside you, put an arm around you, and say, it'll be okay, let's pray together, let's get you back to where you were. Isn't that a wonderful thing that God's forgiving of all these things? But man, isn't that the sad part? Why don't we weep and fall like we used to? There are preachers falling all over America, but which we can fall no more. I don't understand it. I'm on Facebook by force, I'm not on Facebook by desire, I don't care for it really. But because I'm the president of an online Bible college, the minister says you've got to have some kind of presence online. Okay, I'll tell what I've been doing. That's what I'll do. And that's what I do. I don't care for it. I'll tell you why I don't care for it. Because I cannot stand these hypocritical, pseudo-Christians who get on there and bring out everybody's Bible offering as though they've never done anything wrong. But they have been. When Jesus said, cast the first stone, they have been there. They've had a handful of them. They've not had any problem doing that. We can't let that go into that next generation. Because this one thing we've learned about this generation, there's a lot of hurt. There's a lot of the a lot of damage. We've got to find a way. I tell you tonight, my generation's better than us. But you've got to make sure this testimony is done next series. You've got to do it, and you need to do it tonight. An old man going on a long highway came at the evening, holding a breath. The chasm was vast and deep and wide. The winds was flowing in southern tide. The old man crossed the twilight dim, that southern stream had no fear for him. But he turned and went safe on the other side and built a bridge to stand the tide. Old man, said fellow pilgrim dear, you're wasting your strength with building fear. Your journey will end with the ending day. You'll never again pass this way. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why build this bridge at eventide? The builder lifted his old gray head. Good friend, in the path I have come, he said, they followed after me today, a youth whose feet must cross this way. This chasm that has been locked to me, that fair-haired youth may take hold in, he too must cross in the twilight dim. Good friend, I'm building this bridge for thee. That's what you're going to do. And we've got to do it tonight. We can't just put a crown on the next generation. They've got to have a testimony.